हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स. टुडे विल टॉक अबाउट अग्लूटिनेशन. इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट प्रोसेस इन एंटीजन एंटीबॉडी इंटरेक्शन. द रिएक्शन बिटवीन द पार्टिकुलेट एंटीजन एंड एंटीबॉडी रिजल्ट्स इन विजिबल क्लंपिंग कॉल्ड अग्लूटिनेशन. सो द एंटीबॉडीज दैट प्रोड्यूस agglutination reaction are known as agglutinins. The principle behind the agglutination reaction are similar to precipitation reaction and they depend upon cross-linking of polyvalent antigen. When the antigen is an erythrocyte, it is called heme agglutination. All the antibodies can agglutinate particulate antigens, but IgM, due to its high specificity, is a good agglutinin. There are no agglutination observed when the concentration of antibody is high, and when the sample is diluted, then only the agglutination occurs. Here, it's very important to mention the prozone effect. Prozone effect is defined as the invisibility of agglutination at high concentration of antibodies. It is due to the reason that excess antibody form minute complexes that do not clump to form the visible agglutination. So in this diagram you can see the antibodies, they are present. They are marked by blue color and antigen is marked by green color. When the antigen is in excess, then too there is no agglutination. Even when the antibodies they are excess, again there is no agglutination. Agglutination occurs when the optimum zone is there, that is zone of equivalence is there. So agglutination is of many types. First of all, we'll discuss the direct agglutination. Direct agglutination reaction test patient serum for the presence of soluble antibodies against large non-soluble particulate cellular antigens. Direct agglutination reaction can be used to determine the antibody titer. For example, in the case of blood grouping, the direct agglutination antigen is present on the cell surface. So here we can see in this diagram, that is the blood groups, they are of four types, and four types they are blood group A, blood group B, blood group AB and blood group O. In the blood group A, the antigen which is present, it is antigen capital A, and in blood group B, antigen is antigen B. In AB, both antigen A and B, they are present, whereas in the case of blood group O, neither is present, neither A nor B is present on the surface, right? So when the, suppose the blood group B, it is mixed with antibodies anti-B, then what happens? The agglutination takes place. Blood group B antigen will not show clumping if anti-A is added. So agglutination occurs when the antibody combines with the antigen. Second type of agglutination is indirect agglutination. To test patient serum for the presence of antibodies against soluble antigen, serum is mixed with the latex sphere with the soluble antigen attached. So in indirect agglutination, the latex beads, they are used. So the antigens, they are impregnated on the latex bead and then the reaction, it takes place. So antibodies will then cause visible agglutination of the latex sphere with the soluble antigen attached. Alternatively, antibodies may be attached to the latex sphere to test the presence of soluble antigen in the patient serum. So in indirect or passive agglutination, antigen is present on the latex bead. So in these two diagrams, you can well see that in the first diagram, on the latex bead, antigens, they are present and the antibodies, they are responsible for the agglutination. And in the second case, on the latex bead, antibodies, they are present and they are responsible for causing agglutination with the help of antigen present. Next, third type is hemagglutination. Hemagglutination is a specific form of agglutination that involves RBC. Hemagglutination reactions are used in the blood typing, the diagnosis of certain diseases, as well as the identification of viruses. Viral hemagglutination occurs when the spikes on the virus cause agglutination of RBC. There are no antigen antibody interaction. So in this diagram, you can see in the table that RBCs, they are present and they will not interact with any, and there is no reaction in the microtiter results, right, when nothing is added. Second, B case, when viruses, they are added to RBC, it leads to the agglutination, because the spikes which are present on the viruses, they causes the agglutination. That process is known as hemagglutination. In the third case, that is C, the viruses, they are mixed with the antibody as well as the RBCs. In that case, what happens, the antibodies, they block the viruses, they cause neutralization of the viruses, and a result of which the viruses, they will not cause agglutination. That process is known as agglutination inhibition. No agglutination is there. Now coming to the fourth type is the agglutination inhibition. That is a very important technique to determine various components, that is the presence of the antibodies in the serum or the presence of antigen in the serum. So agglutination inhibition, if the antibody is incubated with the antigen prior to mixing with the latex, agglutination is inhibited, because the antibodies and antigens, both the epitopes and paratopes, they are epitope and paratopes, they are fixed, they are not free, and as a result of which, when it is the process, it is continued, no agglutination is there. This is because no free antibodies, they are available for the agglutination. So in agglutination inhibition, the presence of agglutination is diagnosis of antigen. It provides a high sensitivity assay for small quantity of antigen. For example, home pregnancy kits. They contain human chorionic gonadotropin, HCG hormone, coated on the latex particle and antibody to the HCG, right? So a pregnant woman's urine contains HCG, which is secreted by the developing placenta after the fertilization. So the addition of urine containing HCG inhibits agglutination in the latex particle when the HCG antibody is added, and thus the pregnancy is indicated by the absence of agglutination. So in this diagram, you can see the latex beads, they are present, which are coated with the HCG, and in the kit we have got the anti-HCG antibody, right? In these two things we add the urine sample. So when we add the urine sample, in the first case, that is on the left hand side, the HCG which is present in the urine, it blocks the antibodies. Now no free antibodies, they are available for binding with the latex beads containing the antigen. So as a result of which, no agglutination is there, and the test, it seems to be positive. And in the second case, on the right hand side, the HCG, because it is absent in the urine and the antibodies, they are free, they can bind with the antigen present on the latex particle, and the agglutination, it takes place. And if the agglutination is there, the test is negative. So this is known as the agglutination inhibition. Now coming to the last is the bacterial agglutination. So the particulate antigens, such as the bacteria, they combine with specific antibodies to form the complexes that usually aggregate as visible clumps. This is known as the bacterial agglutination. So measure the antibody produced by the host against the bacterial agglutinin. So its uses, bacterial agglutination is used for disease diagnosis. Most appropriate test when the bacterial agent is difficult to cultivate in vitro. So it is used for tetanus, that is for Clostridium tetani, for Yersiniosis, that is Yersinia pestis, then for Leptospirosis, that is Leptospira species. So bacterial agglutination is also important test to find out, to diagnose the presence of various diseases. So in this way, the agglutination is there. So you are going to learn different types of agglutination. I hope the concept is clear. Thank you.